I would like to explicitly pose the question of whether we're seeing in the 21st century a return of utopia in the pre-communist manifesto sense of that term, or whether we would like to see a return of utopia in that pre-communist manifesto sense of that term. As Ernst Bloch put it, extolling a warm Marxism rather than a cold, rational Marxism, utopia has been present in every artistic search for perfection. In music, in literature, in painting, in architecture, you can see the glimpse of the attempt for perfection. And in the pre-communist manifesto sense of utopia, you could also see the attempt for social perfection in the utopian tract, Thomas More's Utopia, the classic attempt to say this is how people could live very differently from how they now live in a harmonious, non-competitive way. Or you could see it in the Owenite experiments, in the attempt to take a community and put it in a natural environment, a small community, where the complexity of governing and planning a large society doesn't get in the way of the attempt of a group of people to develop alternate forms of production and consumption, representation and accountability. What Marx and Engels did in the manifesto was to speak coldly of that sense of utopia. Of course, there was a utopian element in the Communist Manifesto. We want a different society. But what their practice was to identify a subject which is capable of bringing about a transformation of the whole society, and identifying a political agent which can bring that subject to take power in the state and through that to transform the state and transform the society. In that sense, they spoke sneeringly of utopian socialists because they didn't identify an agent and a subject and an agent. And the two, of course, were seen to interact in the Communist Manifesto. What they did was they identified the agency that capitalist society had brought into being, the mass proletariat, the dispossessed, the exploited, right? And it was the first task of every communist. It was the first task of those who were building a party to organize the proletariat into a class, right? So, it's perfectly understandable, perhaps above all in the former Yugoslavia, looking back on what happened to the League of Communists, for whom Marx and Engels were writing the Communist Manifesto, but looking what happened to the League of Communists here, to say, no, we want to go back to the pre-Communist Manifesto sense of utopia. That's what we're putting on the agenda. It's perfectly understandable. I don't think that the organizers of this conference intended this. Moreover, I don't think that is what is happening. I think what is happening is a return to utopia in the sense of we need a class agency and a political agent capable of getting beyond capitalism to a socialist society. Now, how do we get our heads around this? In the decades after the Communist Manifesto was written, one did indeed see the rise, extension, development of an organized proletariat. As the manifesto said, it is organizing more quickly than the bourgeoisie did, not least to its ability to use modern means of communication, railways, telegraphs, etc. The proletariat would become disorganized due to competition amongst workers themselves, but the organization would commence again, deeper, more powerful, more extensive, stronger. And by the time of the First International, you could see the development of a sensible notion in which the proletariat was being turned into a class. And certainly by the time that the truly first great utopian book of the post-communist manifesto period was written, you could see that happening. That book was William Morris's News from Nowhere, called A Utopian Romance, published in 1889. William Morris, I imagine many of you know, was an English painter, craftsman, graphic artist, who became a Marxist in the 1870s, joined the Socialist Federation in the 1880s, and the image of utopia that he built in News from Nowhere, because no such society existed anywhere in his time, right, was one in which people incorporated the traditional English commons, went back to the type of relations of people when there was a common field or forest that they could have access to. But he didn't do this in an antiquarian way. On the contrary, just as in his furniture, just as in his tapestries, just as in his famous wallpaper, yes, he incorporated traditional motives in the objects of everyday life. Right? He did it in such an original way that it wasn't antiquarian. And similarly, that was the picture he painted of a society long into the future, which is visited by a time traveler from the late 19th century. Right? That is what he painted. Yes. But the important thing is that the longest chapter in News from Nowhere is, how did we get there? Very unlike Thomas More's Utopia. Right? The longest chapter by far, like 6 or 7 or 8 times longer than any of the other chapters, is the chapter on how we got there. Morris had been involved in a riot, largely a soldiers' militia police riot against protesting workers in 1887 in Trafalgar Square. And it had shaken him profoundly. And he identifies the moment of revolutionary change as occurring in 1952, 65 years later, also in Trafalgar Square, where there is another demonstration. This time, however, the demonstration is led by the Federation of Combined Working Men, who have been organizing for 65 years. Moreover, that organization, as he says, has been leavened by the active role that self-declared socialists have been playing in that organization. And very much, I think, with an eye to what Jacobin does today or what Machine is doing today, this also involved, as he put it, I'm trying to find the exact quote, the hard work of delivering socialist news. Right? The hard work of delivering socialist news. That's what you do in Jacobin. Isn't that right, Bhaskar? You engage in the hard work of delivering socialist news. That's what you machinists are doing. Right? And it's a process, not just then of organization, but of socialist education. Right? Which has an impact, which leavens the working men, quote unquote, pardon the men, organization. So when there is a demonstration after a crisis in 1952 in Trafalgar Square, and the police do indeed descend upon the protesters, there's a response very different from 1887. There is an attempt to impose martial law, emergency law, in that context, but there is a rising up of the whole society behind the Federation of Working Men, not least because they have effective leadership and tentacles all over the society, and you get a transformation. Okay. In the decades after News from Nowhere was written, you didn't see the emergence of something that had never before emerged in history. And that was permanent organizations of the subordinate classes. There had always been bread riots, usually led by women. There had always been slave revolts. It often looked through the course of the 19th century that the revolts and protests of the proletariat would yield temporary organizations which wouldn't last, as what happened in the United States with the Knights of Labor, or as happened with the Chartists in Britain from the 1830s. But what began to happen by the 1860s, 70s, 80s, 90s was, first of all, not just an organization of craftsmen, of highly skilled engineers, etc., which very much looked like the old medieval guilds. Right? But it was an organization of the semi-skilled, the masses, the great dockers, London, the London dockers strike, right? The people who hauled the heavy crates onto and off the ships of 1889, the London match girl strike, the girls who made matches in the factories. These became permanent organizations of the proletariat, but much more significant, you got between the 1880s and 1920s the emergence of permanent working class political parties. Some of them actually created the unions, which was largely the case in Germany, out of the emergence of the Social Democratic Party, having been driven underground after various attempts through the 1860s and 70s to found itself as a mass party, they begin to create trade unions. In the British case, it's the unions that create the Labour Party as a form of parliamentary representation, of political representation. And of course, all kinds of different confluences of organizations, orientations, et cetera, are coming together in this process. Groups that previously had made an attempt, fallen apart, come back together, et cetera. The 20th century is not a story of News from Nowhere. If you have socialist aspirations, if you have utopian aspirations, if you want to make a systemic change where you live, you're usually telling a story of news from somewhere else. In the 20th century, you're usually saying, ah, look, they did it in Russia. Right? Or if you're living in an advanced capitalist society where the state has deep roots in the social order, and where insurrection is very difficult, therefore, to pull off, there's an attempt to say, ah, look at Sweden. Yes? They point to somewhere else. Right? And old habits die hard. Even now that social democracy has totally been absorbed into the reproduction of capitalism and indeed the reproduction of neoliberalism, even insofar as the communist regimes are dead and gone, and the Chinese Communist Party elite has turned itself venally into a bourgeoisie. Right? Even now, old habits die hard, and those who want a systemic change point to Venezuela. Right? And then they get disappointed. Right. The news from somewhere else, that century of the news from somewhere else, needs to be understood if we're going to talk about the return of utopia, even in the sense that Marx and Engels meant it, maybe especially in the sense that Marx and Engels meant it, right, in the 21st century. The great social democratic parties, their trajectory was already identified by Roberto Michels, I talked about this in Ljubljana 2 years ago, in a book that was published in 1916 called Political Parties, The Iron Law of Oligarchy. I won't go into detail. You can watch that, that lecture in Ljubljana on YouTube. But essentially what it amounts to is an argument that the German Social Democratic Party does begin as the most democratic of organizations. It's created outside of parliament, not by the old parliamentary elites. Right? Its main struggle is to win workers the right to vote, the right to organize. It has annual congresses. It elects its leaders. But making a revolution is not a hobby. It's a very difficult thing to do. Right? So those leaders who are elected stop working in the factory. They become full-time leaders. Right? And for efficiency's sake, they control the party press, the bank account, the agenda of the party congress, when it's called, right, when different subjects will be discussed, what order they'll be discussed in, etc. Right? Moreover, they're now spending their days not with their fellow workers in the factory, in the office, on the docks, etc. They're spending their days with the leaders of the bourgeois parties in parliament. Right? Or negotiating with the bosses. And they begin to recognize that these people don't eat babies for breakfast, that they're also human beings. And they develop relationships with them. But more than that, they don't want to go back to the factory floor. So they use, there's a tendency. He doesn't say this is inevitable, not everybody does it in the same way, etc. They use their control of the party organization in order to arrange matters so that they're likely to get reelected. Right? And moreover, in order to get reelected, they stop passing on the knowledge that they are accumulating of how to create organizations, how to run organizations, and they don't pass that on to the members as much, because the more you pass it on, the more you might produce challengers. On the masses' side, there's an enormous deference to the leadership. When have they had people speaking for them? And it's indeed always been the case that the leaders of the socialist parties have a much longer longevity than do leaders of bourgeois parties. Right? Someone's speaking for me. Yes, and there's a high degree of deference. This is what he calls the iron law of oligarchy. And it looks a great deal like the German Social Democratic Party at the beginning of World War I. And it was pretty well that trajectory, the trajectory established by the German Social Democratic Party when it joined the nation in the inter-imperial role in World War I, that was then incorporated as these parties came into government, right, and introduced what William Morris, with unbelievable perspicacity, writing in the late 1880s, called state socialism. He didn't mean by that the state socialism you had here. He meant by that social democracy, the introduction of reforms that ameliorated capitalism but left wage slavery in place, as he put it, and left the contradictions of capitalism, the tendency to crises, in place. And that's exactly what he was describing that led up to the crisis of 1952. Now, insofar as revolutionary ambitions, utopian ambitions, were sustained through the 20th century, it was because of the Russian Revolution. It was explicitly because there were so many people from the Second International, of which the German Social Democratic Party was the model party, which broke from it. Right? And out of that came the communist movement, the Third International. Right? The key event, of course, was October 1917. In that instance, and also with determining effect for the rest of the century, that revolution immediately produced a civil war. And in the context of that civil war, coming at the end of a world war, it produced enormous shortages, rationing, hardship, etc. It was probably the case by December 1917, certainly the case by sometime in 1918, that the Bolsheviks lost support of the working class that had put them there, that had formed the Soviets, that had written up, etc. And it was in the context, no socialist theorist had ever thought of this. Once you've won the working class, you might lose it. And it was in the context of recognizing that if they kept free elections, they would lose power. And if they lost power, believing that nobody else, least of all the syndicalists, who didn't believe in organization at the national political level, right, would be capable of holding on to the revolution against the counter-revolution. And it was in that context that they removed independent parties, the political life of a democratic state, not that one had existed to any great sense in Russia before. And Rosa Luxemburg, where is she? Of course, saw this very early on, and in 19 she wrote, Lenin, she noted, saw the capitalist state as the instrument of oppression of the working class, the socialist state as the instrument of oppression of the bourgeoisie. But this, she said, and I'm quoting, misses the most essential thing. Bourgeois class rule has no need of the political training and education of the entire mass of the people, at least not beyond certain narrow limits. The great danger was that without general elections, without unrestricted freedom of the press and assembly, without a free struggle of opinion, life dies out in every public institution, becomes a mere semblance of life in which only the bureaucracy remains the active element. Public life gradually falls asleep. A few dozen party leaders of inexhaustible energy and boundless experience direct and rule by themselves. Among them, in reality, only a dozen outstanding heads do the leading, and an elite of the working class is invited from time to time to meetings where they are to applaud the speeches of the leaders. and to approve proposed resolutions unanimously, at bottom then a clique affair. And I've talked here before, not in Belgrade, but in Zagreb and Kumrovic, of Ljubljana, of how I was here in 1989 speaking to the party school, to the League of Communist School. And there was precisely that elite being trained to become the party apparatchiks of the future. And I did nothing except tell them the story of Michel's book, The Iron Law of Oligarchy. And they didn't know what to do when I had finished. Usually they expected that they should pick up their hands and pass a resolution they'd been requested to pass. It was already the case by the 1960s that my generation, and Hillary spoke of it very movingly, I thought, just before, that our generation recognized that both social democracy and the communist parties no longer contained the utopian dream of the matter, as Ernst Bloch called it. They were pragmatists. Both of them in their different ways. They were not at all utopians. They were not at all dreamers. They were not aiming at what William Morris imagined. That was obvious. It took another couple of decades before the communist regimes, you know, who thought they could, through the Central Committee, pronounce the end of capitalism. And what they actually did was, through the Central Committee, pronounce the end of communism, right? By a common resolution of the Central Committee. Right? And it took another few decades before social democracy fully embraced the neoliberal capitalist globalization in which they were caught up. There were attempts, not least because of the types of developments outside the parties that Hillary was speaking to, not only in the women's movement, also in the beginnings of the environmental movement, in these movements for sexual liberation, etc. There were attempts to transform those old parties or create new ones. It was really quite astonishing when you think of it. It was only 15 years later, after 1952, when Morris's revolution didn't happen, right? But I was in Trafalgar Square in 1967, 15 years later, in the most magnificent demonstration against Britain's complicity in the Vietnam War. And then a few months later, you had May 68 in Paris, right? A few months later after that, you had August in Prague, with people putting flowers down the barrels of Soviet tanks. And a few months after that, you had Chicago, the last attempt to transform the Democratic Party into a vehicle for transformative change. Perhaps naively, perhaps not, maybe more naively then than today, but that was what was going on. That was called the new politics. And it drew many of the movement activists into that attempt in the following years. That failed. It failed, but it left a legacy. What Hillary was referring to in the Greater London Council, a type of municipal socialism, which wasn't just providing public housing, which wasn't just providing sewage for the city, right? Was sending people like Hillary and Sheila Rothbotham into the working class areas of the city and saying, we will facilitate you organizing a different way of producing and consuming. We'll provide resources for it, we'll help link it to, we'll help do economic planning for it at a local level. Right? Tony Benn emerged articulating the voice of the movement saying, I am primarily an educator. I'm not primarily a representative. My role as a politician is to make socialists. Right? And saying, if you can't democratize the Labour Party, you can't democratize the state. And he produced an even more horrific response than Corbyn is producing from the establishment today. There were similar attempts in the communist parties. The Euro-communist current emerged by the mid to late 1960s. Some of it was motivated by exactly the same kind of ideas, perhaps with a deeper appreciation of the dynamics of capitalism than was the case on the left of the Democratic Party or on the left of the Labor Party. But nevertheless, also bearing in mind Gramsci's understanding so soon after Lenin, that in those states where, in those capitalist societies where the state was deeply embedded, right, where it wasn't just a superstructure with no pillars underneath it, where the state was deeply embedded, an insurrectionary path to utopia was not going to work. Right? Gramsci had understood that. And the Communist Party of Italy, even the Communist Party of France, which was always much more Stalinist than the Italian one, right, moved towards not only a parliamentary road to socialism, but really to a view that if we could get to Swedish social democracy, we'd be very happy. That's even what Gorbachev wanted. Right? Their image was no longer utopia unless you define Sweden as utopia. Although we've seen, of course, in the dynamics of globalization, that even Sweden has gotten caught up in commodification and competitiveness, etc. In that context, not surprisingly, you saw a tremendous decline of the Communist Manifesto meaning of transformation. You saw immediately the emergence of a spate of writings which were utopian in the sense that Marx criticized. Some of those were texts on market socialism, ironically. Right? Yugoslavia was falling apart and people were identifying what we need is self-managed enterprises plus markets. Right? No trade unions, thank you, and the unions need to repress their wage demands and so on. Kornai, of course, was the leading figure in this, but there were many of them. Right? Or you got, astonishingly, given that they kept calling it utopia, the type of societies envisaged, which really didn't look all that different from capitalism. If you take a look at Eric Olin Wright's Real Utopias series with Verso, right, you will see in it a book by two very famous American left academics, Bowles and Guintis. One's a sociologist, one's an economist, and they are speaking to the neoliberal economists primarily. And they say, if we have markets and self-managed enterprises, we will then be able to have higher productivity in the United States than we have under capitalism. Why would that be? Because since workers have an interest in the distribution of the profits, they will drive each other to be more competitive and more efficient. So it's adopting the logic of competition in order to make a case for utopia, rather than a vision of a cooperative, harmonic, democratic society. And of course, you recognize that grain of truth even in the type of self-managed markets that you had here in that respect. Or, most astonishingly, you got from Frederick Jameson just a few years ago, now in a big fat book on which there's commentary edited by Zizek, an American utopia. Do you know what that utopia is? Jameson says, I thought about 2007 that if we're going to have socialized healthcare in the United States, we already have it. We have it in the military. It's non-commodified. Every soldier gets it. There's veterans' hospitals, you don't pay to go to them. Yes, they're underfunded, they're not as good, but we have socialized healthcare. Our model for the utopia should be the American military. There's even economic planning there, he says. Now, to be fair, there were other utopias which were much more ambitious and transformative. The greatest of them, published in the early 1990s, was a book by Albert and Hanel called Participatory Economics for the 21st Century. It's been out in various iterations, and you should get hold of it. It's really worth reading. First of all, it's very funny. It takes a command central planner. It takes a Hayekian free market economist. It takes a market socialist. And it takes a participatory economics advocate. And the person who is most confused is the market socialist. The least logical is the market socialist. The image of the society developed there is one in which the division of labor begins to be broken down in the self-managed enterprises. It's exactly what Hillary was talking about. Yes, not everybody can be a pilot. But the pilot should at least have some experience of what it feels like to be at the counter. And insofar as there are women who are clerks on the counter, they should give them given the chance of training to be a pilot. Why not? They do the same thing in a print shop. They do the same thing in a hospital, etc. Without being completely unrealistic, there's an attempt to at least attenuate the division of labor. Moreover, there's an attempt to make the case for democratic economic planning, right, of a kind whereby each community, each neighborhood, will each year set out a set of priorities after democratic discussions, street by street, in terms of what they want the plan to articulate and produce in the following period. It's complex, it's not always entirely believable or plausible, but there's an attempt to lay it all out, and it's impressive. The trouble with it is how the hell do you get there? There's not a word, not a comma, on how you're going to get from here to there. And that's what Marx and Engels meant by using utopian socialists in a sneering way. It was a time, the 1990s, the first decade of the 2000s, where people rejected the Communist Manifesto premise that what you needed was a social subject that was transformative, one that could cohere the transformative capacities of humanity, and a party that could help form it into a class. It was, of course, those were the decades of identity politics, quite rightly so, given the marginalizations and oppressions that so many people feel in the many diverse sides of their lives. Of course, people are never born as workers. Right? They're born as black, white, men, women, football enthusiasts, checker players, Scrabble players, what have you. Insofar as there would have ever been a proletariat, which became a transformative class, and there's no necessity that that proletariat, without political organization and education, would become a transformative class, insofar as it wasn't incorporating all of the diverse elements that were embedded in it, it would be less capable of being transformative. So I'm not saying that the identity politics struggles, right, were not important in that respect. But they had nothing to do with socialism. What they had to do with was ensuring that as many women as were a proportion of the population were CEOs, right, as men. The other women can be wage slaves. It was about ensuring that as many black people could get into Harvard as they were a portion of the population. The others could go to a shitty state school. Right? That was combined with an era of protest. Neoliberalism, although Perry Anderson called it the most successful ideology in world history, was always contested. Always contested. By 1995, the Indian peasants were already revolting against the free trade in agriculture. 1999, you already had Seattle. And I don't have to tell you about what happened here in Europe through the course of the first decade of the 20th century in terms of anti-neoliberal globalization protests. As capitalism penetrated every corner of the earth and every dimension of our lives. And we heard earlier today how it commodified really the most common elements of our lives, health, water, right? Unbelievable. Things that had never before been commodified. This wasn't a matter, right, of something that previously had been private, turned public, and then they made it private again. Nowhere in human history was water ever merely a private commodity. Right? Might have, as for health, it might have been a charity. Might have been run by churches, by benevolent societies. It wasn't a commodity, right? Not for the whole mass of society. And there was always protest against this. But what was not happening, right, was the formation or even the interest in the formation of what Marx called for. Moreover, increasingly in the era of the precariat, as the proletariat, which had become organized, was now becoming disorganized and was turning back again into a dispossessed precariat, right? Nor was there much evidence that it was cohering again. The defeat of trade unionism everywhere is what marks the neoliberal capitalist era. Right? So it was quite understandable that if people had utopian aspirations, they had it in the pre-communist manifesto sense. But something has happened. We are in a new conjuncture. We are in a new conjuncture. And the conjuncture is defined by two main elements. The first has to do with capitalism. And that is that while neoliberalism has been reproduced in the second decade of the 21st century, after the crisis of 2007-08, neoliberal structures, neoliberal practices, indeed they've been intensified in the way you were talking about. The legitimation of neoliberalism, which was always testy, right, has now actually undermined the political institutions of neoliberalism. The hollowing out of the social democratic parties, the hollowing out of their support, right? Because of their complicity in neoliberalism, their complicity in competitiveness, their identification with each nation state, right? And their definition of the national interest as that of being competitive in global capitalism and making their workers competitive in global capitalism. And it's not only those institutions that have lost their social base, what was left of their class base. The international institutions of neoliberalism are being weakened and hollowed out, above all the European Union. But not only. The most important international institution in managing international capitalism is the American Empire. And its capacity to manage global capitalism has been severely compromised, as most clearly seen in the fact that the American Treasury wanted, all through this crisis under the Obama administration, to have large fiscal deficits, not to have autarky and austerity. And it wasn't able to because it didn't have a majority in Congress, but even more, it wasn't able to persuade the German state, let alone the European Central Bank, as it had been able to in the 1990s, to be a firefighter in the crisis. The German state kept on throwing oil on the flames of the debt crisis in Europe, not only in Southern Europe, right, but even of the banks. And you now see its effect in terms of the weakness of the Deutsche Bank, which tried to turn itself into Goldman Sachs Europe. But something else is happening, apart from the hollowing out of the institutions, right? And that is a shift from protest to politics on the part of people who don't like neoliberalism. A shift of protest to politics from those who want a better world, a different world, who think in the old pre-communist manifesto terms of a different world. Right? Indeed, try to establish little co-ops, get very excited because in Argentina, when they default on the debt, when people are thrown out on the streets, some of them take over their factories and have these tiny little workshops, right? Which then Naomi Klein makes a movie about. Right? And initially, people thought they were doing that on Wall Street, in Occupy, right? They were running Occupy not just as a protest, but as a way of articulating democracy, the way in which people spoke to one another in a horizontal way rather than speaking, as I'm doing to you, through the front, right? But also attempting to actually live in those spaces in a communal way. As if living in Zuccotti Square would be an example for the world to learn to live that way. But after Occupy, and it's astonishing really, after the indignados, there has been this shift to politics. I think what has happened in politics couldn't have happened without Occupy. Moreover, what was so important about it was that the protest at the beginning of this decade was very class-focused. It wasn't class-rooted. It was all about inequality now, right? The 1%. Right? There's been this very rapid turn to we need a party, the question that Vladimir asked Hillary. We can't be utopian without getting into the state. We can't be utopian without organizing the social forces into a transformative class. That's what's going on. That's why it's produced the new parties, although Syriza's really, if you look at its history, not so new, and that's why it was able to get into government so fast. It came out of the Euro-communists in the Greek movements from the 1960s, really. But in any case, new party Syriza gets into government, the only party in the context of this crisis, the only radical left party that has managed to get into the state, produces Podemos, and then, most astonishingly, it produces the Corbyn insurgency and the Sanders insurgency inside the Labour Party and the Democratic Party. Much of my work through my whole long intellectual career has been to make the case that you can't change the Labour Party into a socialist party. You can't change an elephant into a gazelle. But now, what can I do but look closely at the phenomenon of 300,000-400,000 people joining a social democratic party? It's astonishing. Young people. And moreover, young people who understand what Hillary says, that we don't only need, we're not only doing this to get Corbyn elected or him resurrected a year later. Right? We're doing this in order to get into the communities and change the party-movement relationship. Develop people's capacities to imagine and practice alternate forms of production and consumption. And that's what Syriza most explicitly put on the table. If you read the final paragraphs, maybe someone in this room helped write them. If you read the final paragraphs of its 2013 program, the year before it was elected, it says, getting us into the state will not do anything unless there is a catalytic, diverse movement of subversion in society. But then, what happens? And I'm not saying this critically. And this is our great dilemma. The great dilemma about the return of utopia. What happens? They go into the Greek state. It's a corrupt, patronage-ridden state. They know it. They've said it. It's one of the reasons they get elected, because they said it so openly. Right? They take their best cadre with them into the state, and they find how bloody hard it is to change it, even apart from the fact that the Germans won't let them breathe. Right? And they've taken all their best cadre out of the party. Hillary was alluding to this. So they're no longer in the party, embedding themselves in the solidarity movements, developing an interest in, let alone a capacity for, alternate forms of production and consumption, and then you expect them to walk away from the European Union? Well, how are they going to survive? If they don't know, they don't have, they haven't planned for, nobody has an interest in, nobody has a capacity for alternate forms of production and consumption. To pull out of the euro means you have to have capital controls and import controls. If you have import controls, you can't be in the European Union. If you're not in the European Union, then what do you do to have a different way of living than 3 decades of integration, economic integration into the European Union? Well, maybe you turn to Iran for money, like Castro turned to Russia, right? Maybe you turn to Putin. But then you forget that there's a big NATO base sitting there in Crete with the planes flying low every day over Crete. Right? So you see that it isn't, this is no hobby. It's very easy for the ultra-leftists to point fingers. We are in an appalling dilemma. The dilemma is that William Morris was right, we probably need 65 years to turn the precariat back into a working class. We probably need 65 years to develop through socialist education the capacities that are needed to transform the state, which may be even more difficult if it's not a patronage-ridden, corrupt, clientelistic state. If it's a Weberian bureaucratic state, it may even be more difficult. We need 65 years. But the current conjuncture we're in gives us no time. What neoliberalism is producing is a xenophobic, racist set of institutions which are moving into the hollowed out institutions of neoliberalism. Right? We have no time. When Tsipras said, it would be entirely irresponsible of me not to say, I really want to form a government and I'll form it with whoever will form it in order to stop the torture of the Greek people. You understand why he felt that, right? You understand why people wanted Sanders to win, to beat Hillary, to get in. Can you imagine what it would have been like, Sanders sitting in the Oval Office of the American Empire, right? Without the capacities to transform even the Department of Labor, let alone the Defense Department or the Treasury or the Federal Reserve? Those of us who hope there'll be a transformation in the Labor Party or the Democratic Party, and I hope there will, if it concentrates on an internal party revolution and doesn't develop the capacities outside, the danger is it'll end up like the Brazilian Workers' Party that Hillary referred to, or even worse, like the ANC, Communist Party, COSATU Alliance in South Africa. It's a terrible dilemma. And I congratulate you for organizing a conversation around the return of utopia in this context. Thank you.